First challenge is penalty shootout, where we put influencers and the fans and me, the host, Cecil G, against each other to see who's really about this ball life.
Wait, I'll take you.
Don't rob me.
No, I'll take you one.
Alright, go on.
Here we go.
Hi, welcome along to AFTV. That's a brand new series called How's Your Touch, which is available on the AFTV Mobi. You've got to check out that penalty shootout. But welcome along to the show today. Really looking forward to my very special guest that we've got on today, a legend of the Arsenal game. And I'm going to bring him on in a second. But first of all, before I bring him on, I'm sure you guys would have seen the really sad news today about Heavy D. That really touched me when I saw that news come out today that Heavy D, you've seen him featured on the channel many times, given his interviews, a larger than life character, sadly passed away today. And I want to send all my condolences going out to his family. It's just such sad news. And then also Diego Maradona as well. Hearing about that today as well, a guy that I grew up watching, was just an unbelievable player. Unbelievable character, hero of Argentina, and he passed away today as well. I think football's gonna really, really miss him. So my condolences to his family as well. But bringing in my very special guest today, ex-Arsenal striker, TV pundit as well. He does everything. We've got Kevin Campbell in the house. Kevin, how you doing, Kev?
Robbie, good to see you, and I'm doing really good, thank you, mate. Plenty to discuss, and I've got plenty energy for this show.
Great to see you, man. I mean, what I just mentioned there, the two people that passed away today. First of all, Heavy D. I don't know if you ever met him, but I'm sure you would have seen his videos on the channel. A real character.
I met Heavy D. I met Heavy D a few times, and always had a good laugh, always had good banter, was always jovial type of guy. You know, and obviously there was people who didn't quite like him because he was always kind of the life and soul of everything. But I always got along with him, and you know, he was harmless to me. But you never wish bad on people. You know,
me and him had a little bit of falling out towards the end. What? Not even a falling out. You know, I didn't have a falling out with him at all. I know he was upset with me because there was a video that he wanted to be run on the channel, and at the time he wanted to run it, the timing weren't right for that video. But I couldn't fall out with that guy. You know what I mean? Like you said, he was just like a bundle of laughs. He was so much fun. When he used to turn up to the games with his belt and stuff like that, I remember saying to him one day, I go, yeah, Heavy D, I go, what do you keep doing this boxing thing for, man? I go, you're going in against these guys, they'll kill you. You know what I mean? And he goes, nah, Robbie, you know what? He goes, it's something that helps me to get into the gym. If I didn't do it, I wouldn't go to the gym. Yeah. And I was like, wow, you know what I mean? And I really, really touched me. And then the Maradona thing, you as a footballer, you know, you would have been playing, well he was before your time, right?
But
you, surely when you were playing, you would have been idolizing that type of player.
Well, Robbie, when you look at Maradona, no disrespect to any of them, but he is in the conversation of one of the greatest ever. So you could talk about legend and all that, but he is he's one of the greatest ever players. And, you know, the way, look, I hated him, Robbie, when he done the hand of God. I'm telling you the truth. I hated him. But you know what? Then he came up with that goal, the next one where he dribbled past everybody, and you just have to say, wow, man, the guy's special. You know, what he done at Napoli and what he done for Argentina. He's a character. And you always hear it, these type of characters are not in football anymore.
Yeah.
And it's just another sad one, man. Another good one gone.
You know what? With Maradona, right? And this argument's always going to pop up, right? But I'm old enough to remember him playing and that, right? And like you said, what he did, he went to Napoli. They hadn't won nothing.
Yeah.
And, you know, when he went there, they won the league and stuff like that. How would you compare him? Like, if you compare him to, like, obviously the comparisons are going to be made with him and Messi and, you know, him and Ronaldo. there's a lot of people, like, I remember my dad always used to say to me, he used to go, yo, he's better than them two. Because he, you know, he won the World Cup, literally, like, he was the driving force when Argentina won the World Cup and Messi didn't win the World Cup.
Yeah. Robbie, I think as well, because it was a different era. Remember, there was no social media. There was none of this, what these modern players have got, where you can actually see a lot of the goals and the games, the ability that they do. You know, every skill is magnified. Maradona done it in a time where Italian football defensively was as hard as you can get in football. The Gentiles and all that, you know, the Milan team, Baresi, all of them.
Plus, he was the man. It's true. And plus as well, in those days, as you know, playing a little bit later on, as you said, if you went past a player and you skilled him up a couple of times, you're getting chopped down, isn't it? And no one...
Robbie, that's when you could tackle from behind as well. You know, the defender's got a free hit at you. And he had to deal with Italy, man. And I've just got to say, he was... People talk about legends, man. This guy was, he was, at that time, he was by far the best player in the world. There was nobody who could touch Maradona. And, you know, he's just so sad, Robbie.
What would his transfer fee have been like if he would have been around nowadays? He would have been, you know.
500 million, man. I'm telling you, 500, because what he could do, not only was he good ability-wise, Robbie, he made everyone around him. Do you remember Carreca, who was at Napoli?
Yeah, yeah.
He made Carreca better. He made a load of those guys. Zola was around. He made them all great. Do you know what I mean? So you've got to take your hat off to this guy. I'm so sad. I didn't like him, Robbie. I've got to be honest. I hated him for the hand of God goal.
The hand of
but
God,
I hold
yeah.
my hands up. He was a special, special player, man.
Definitely, man. Oh, you know what? There's this really funny comment here. I want you to read this one, Kev, yeah? It says, tell Kevin he looks a lot like the Campbell that plays for Stoke. There's a reason why he looks like the Campbell who plays for Stoke, because that's his son.
Yeah, that's my son. That's my eldest boy.
Your son is tearing it up at the moment, isn't he?
Robbie, he's doing okay right now. Robbie, there's a lot more to come from him, because really it's the first time he's really getting a run of games consistently. You know, he's on his fifth manager in 2 years. You know, that's a lot of managers and a lot of water under the bridge to get through. But finally he's getting some stability and some consistency. And I believe there's a lot more to come. I know there is.
I like you say that like a real dad, you know. Like everybody else will be round him raving, and that's why you need your parents, you know. Because everyone else is probably round him saying, "Yo, y'all kill it, man! Yes, man!
You ain't done nothing yet."
And then you just go to him and go, "Yo, just chill out, man."
You ain't done nothing yet, Robbie.
That's why you need people like your parents around you, because they'll just level you down and
humble you.
Yeah. Yeah,
but you know what, Robbie? He's a humble kid anyway. He always says to me, "Dad, I've got to get better. I've got to get better," because he knows where he wants to be. Mm. So he's of the mindset. Great that I'm in the team, but I want to be consistent and I want to get better.
Well, he's having a great season so far, and you know what? That leads me on to a lot of what we're going to talk about. Let's just talk about that straight away. Mm-hmm. You just said there, you know. He's had to be patient. It's taken time. He's had different managers and things like that. Do we as fans, have to be patient with the situation at Arsenal at the moment? Because over the past couple of weeks, you know what I mean? Fans have been losing it on here over, you know, some of, you know, the Aston Villa performance, what happened at Leeds with the sending off and stuff like that. Where do you stand on it all? Is the same with fans, that we have to be a bit more patient? It does take a little time in football, or do you see big problems at Arsenal?
I don't see big problems. I just think everything has culminated in one. Here's the reason why, Robbie. We are not playing well as a team. We are not. Certain individuals have decent games, But the majority, when you're going to be playing well, you need 7 or 8 players playing well to carry the other 3, not the other way around, where there's maybe 3 players playing okay and there's 8 players who are not playing okay. That's the first thing. The second thing is, when you're not playing well and you're not taking your chances, Robbie, it's going to drive people mad. You know, you could win the game 1-0 or whatever. We beat Manchester United we performed on that day. And then the week after, he changed 10 players in the Europa League. He brings a team in that beat Manchester United. And we look like the dog and duck. Don't we? We look like strangers out there. And do you know the crazy thing, Robbie? I truly believe that performance absolutely shocked Mikel Arteta. It absolutely shocked him, because what he sent that team out there to do, they never done it. And you could see after the game, he was shocked.
Yeah, I mean, strikers-wise, let's talk on that. Obviously, you were a striker for Arsenal, very successful striker for Arsenal Football Club. Did you ever go for a patch like what Lacazette's going through at the moment, right? Where, you know, he seems at the moment like he's missed some big chances. Like you said, you've got to take your chances. And he's missed some big chances. Is this a loss of form for him, or is this him on the wane? Or what would you, you know, because he's been decent over the seasons.
Yeah, I think Lacazette suffers with confidence, a lack of confidence. And it's easy to lose confidence, Robbie, because, you know, the way he started the season, he started quite good. He was scoring quite regularly and stuff like that. But once the team doesn't start hitting form constantly, and he starts to snatch at chances, and none of the real chances falls to Aubameyang, which is why the fans are going crazy that Aubameyang's on the left, he needs to be in the middle. They tended to fall to Lacazette. Now, if you remember rightly, Lacazette scored one against Leicester that got chalked off. That would have been great for his confidence. But you chalk that off, and then you're scratching around, and you end up losing the game. So that puts them on a downer, and the team just ain't playing well enough. So I've been there. I know what it feels like. But there's only one place to put it right. That's on a training pitch. And then when you get on that pitch, to take some of these chances, because that's the only way you get through it.
Is Arteta too defensive in his play? Right, because I had DT on the other night. We was having a big argument, right? So, you know, a lot of people are saying that, you know, not having Ozil and that, which, you know, we'll come on to that later as well, right? But obviously that we do lack creativity without him. But even so, I'm looking at, like, the other day, I saw Brighton play Aston Villa. Mm-hmm. Brighton's creating chances. They're getting forward. They're getting players into the box. And I'm looking around at that Brighton team and I'm like, they're not better than us.
Not a patch on us.
Who would I have from, you know, I mean, they got Welbeck, who we had, right, scoring. They got, I mean, I think the only player I'd look in their team and say, right, I would definitely have him, is like maybe a Lamptey or someone like that. And they're super attacking team. Now, is it the style of play from Mikel Arteta why we are not creating chances? We're not creating nothing, Kev.
We're not creating chances, Robbie, for 2 reasons. One, you've got to be able, when you get across that white line, you've got to be able to perform. And there's too many players who are not performing. So Mikel Arteta could do all the work he wants on the training pitch. He doesn't send them out there to be defensive. That's for sure. He doesn't. Because we've seen 100%. 100%. You don't send Arsenal out at the Emirates at home to be defensive. That's an easy one for fans to come out with. He sends them out too defensive. Absolute nonsense.
All right, hold on. Now comes when we play that.
No, hold on. Let me finish.
Okay.
He sends them out there to do a job, because there's 2 sides to football. There's one when you have the ball and one when you don't have the ball. Against Manchester United, this is the contrast of our team. Against Manchester United, we should have beaten them 3 or 4, Robbie. True. We just couldn't take our chances. against Aston Villa, we deserve nothing, because you can't tell me he sends them out against Manchester United to be positive, and then you get home and he sends them out to be negative. Nonsense.
What were the formation?
Robbie, that's the excuse everybody could use. Don't matter what formation you do. Don't matter whether he changed it against Leeds. It never changed. So all this formation and all, players make formations. It isn't the formation that makes the players.
Yeah, but look at the lack of service to players like, say, Aubameyang. Like I said, you played as a striker, yeah? Mm-hmm. If you get very few balls up to you, right? I can't remember him getting a ball in behind him, right? In that, I think in that game against Aston Villa, he didn't have a shot on goal, mm-hmm. right? If he's not getting any service and you played as a striker, what are you going to do?
You're going to have to start foraging. Because, Robbie, you've got to understand, when you're a striker, you rely on your teammates to get you the ball. This is what you do. You rely on them. Aubameyang isn't a player like a Bergkamp who can just create something out of nothing. He's not that type. Or a Henry who can just pick it up and go. He relies on service. And if you give him the service, he will score the goals. But Robbie, when you're not playing well, the team ain't playing well. And all this about Arsenal are not creative. I've never had so much crap in all my life. Arsenal have created chances, but they haven't taken them. I'm not saying they've created 10 chances a game, but they have created chances. But when you don't take them, Robbie, you are going to come unstuck. And that's what's happened to Arsenal right now. They're not playing well enough as a team, and the chances that come fall maybe to not Aubameyang, but Lacazette, and they're not being converted.
Okay, Gurish says when Arsene Wenger came, he had the best back four, which did not change for two years.
Yeah.
He worked from front to back. Mikel Arteta needs 2 years to make his own team. Patience. I'm going to take you up again, though, Kev, right? On, mm-hmm. Come on. I know you're right. The team's not performing. But this game sometimes, right? We've had we've barely created anything in the whole game. Yeah. It's like two shots on goal and things like that.
Yeah.
We're not used to seeing Arsenal with two shots on goal. And there's players there that seem to be playing in too much of a rigid system. It's like you play there, don't move. You do this. I don't see enough players picking up the ball and drive. Do you remember on Sunday? There was one time in that game, Bellerin picked the ball up. He drove past about a couple
went
players.
Went inside.
I don't see enough of that in games. Why?
Confidence, Robbie. Robbie, football, 70% of it is confidence. When the team are confident, everybody, it looks fluid, it looks nice, etc. But when people ain't playing well, people tend to want to not express themselves too much because the mentality isn't, I'm going to be the big man and I'm going to show. It's going to be, I'm just going to do my job. But by doing that, by being negative, they're not doing their job. And Aston Villa proved it. Aston Villa ripped us. Leeds ripped us. We were lucky to get away with a point. And we still nearly won the game. If Saka would have taken that chance, we would have ended up winning the game. So, again, we are not playing well. There will be bumps in the road under Arteta. We are not a club where we can't get bumps in the road. So Arteta has to ride the bumps, and we will improve. I believe that. I truly believe we will improve. Just a difficult time at the moment.
Kelly says, why do we need confidence? They're all pros, right? Well, you're a pro.
They are. But everybody you play against are pros. So when your confidence is down and the opposition is up, it's going to be a lot more difficult for you. But when you're playing with confidence, you, man for man, we are better than Villa. But Villa's confidence was high and ours wasn't. So Villa...
Why was it low, Kev? We just beat a Manchester United the week before.
Robbie, we are so
high.
Yeah, it should be, Robbie. Yeah, Robbie.
Were they complacent in that game?
Robbie, whether it's complacency, whether it's whatever it is, Robbie, we are inconsistent in the league and we have been for a number of years. When it, even under Emery, when it came down to the crunch of them 8 games where we could qualify for the Champions League, what performances did the team put in? We get beat at home to Crystal Palace and then we draw against Brighton at home. Fluffed our lines. We are not consistent as a team. And let me just ask you this and the people who are on the streaming, right? How long were we asking for a centre-half and a centre-midfielder? How long?
Yeah, long time.
Mikel Arteta hasn't even been there a year. And the one transfer window he gets, he tries to address those problems. But it's not going to happen overnight. We still have the same players who have been promising the earth and not producing. So, you know, this isn't quite his team yet. And we're trying to make them, yeah, they're good players. But, Robbie, the mentality isn't there. A lot of them are soft, as far as I'm concerned. They're okay. Soft.
Wow. Damning. Fee Jacobs says, Robbie, I've never seen Kevin play. Describe his gameplay to me. Well, you know, if I was to compare you to a player now, like you said, they're all soft now. I know you weren't soft. You weren't soft. I'm trying to think of, if I was comparing you to a player in the Premier League right now.
I don't think
Calvert-Lewin? Like, you'd be
probably, the physicality was different.
Because
you know what I mean? The physicality's different.
Who would you say? Who would you compare yourself to now? If you looked at one player in the Premier League and you say, is that striker similar to me? Because I'm trying to think.
None in the Premier League. Because if you remember, Robbie, I played striker, target man, wide left, wide right, right mid, right left
mid. That's what I'm saying. For me, the closest I can get is possibly Calvert-Lewin.
Calvert-Lewin, maybe. As a target man, yeah.
Yeah.
Probably, because
Mitrovic, but he was way more mobile than Mitrovic.
Yeah.
He's way better than those men as well.
And Robbie, this is the thing. The mentality of that Arsenal squad, this is how you know this team are soft. And I mean that in the best possible way. I don't mean that disrespectful to them. But when you're in the trenches against a team like Villa and you're not playing well, that Arsenal team could grind out a 1-0. You knew we weren't playing well, but you knew everybody will be on it and stop them and we'll get a goal and we'll win the game 1-0. Now, when you're not playing well, we get done 3-0 at home.
Yeah. Brandon, AFC Fan TV with a super chat. I can't find it on to get up on the screen, but he says, we're set up negatively. I don't mind this system when we play a big side away from home, but not against Villa and Leeds, a team that has just been promoted. We should be taking the game to them. The Leeds one, I think the system was right. The one at Villa, I said right from the beginning, I didn't like that system. We're at home. Why are we playing?
Robbie. How many times?
I'm disagreeing with you on this one, Kev.
Yeah, well, you can. And you know what?
Robbie.
The
guy's right. When we played against Villa, that was too negative. That worked against Man United, right? I understood that. But we were at home and we're playing Villa. Villa, who everybody knows attacking-wise, they're very strong, but they're very weak defensively. And we didn't even have a go at them.
Robbie, we played poorly. What part of playing poorly don't you or your guys understand? I don't get it, Robbie. So, again, against Manchester United, we're on the front foot. We're aggressive. We're hunting them down. Do you seriously think Mikel Arteta will send them out at the Emirates and say, look, I want us to be defensive today? Not in a month of Sundays. Come on. No chance. They just played poorly, Robbie. They played poorly. Mikel Arteta had 2 weeks to kind of tweak everything in his head for Leeds. We go to Elland Road. There's changes that people have been crying out for. Nothing changed. Pepe got himself sent off. And we actually played better with 10 men. Why? Because we had to be rigid. We had to be tough. We had to be a bit stronger. We had to turn up. But before then, Robbie, we got lucky. We got lucky against Leeds.
Amory Nair with a super chat. He says, we can afford to lack creativity only if we are clinical. He's backing up what you're saying. He goes, remember our loss against Leicester, who were just that. We need two strikers who can score out of nowhere. That's a good point. And then I'm loving some of the comparisons that are coming in, comparing you to players. Henry Frasel compares you to Benzema. I can see that one.
Maybe as a foil, because obviously when I played with Wrighty,
yeah,
I was the foil. So you did as a partnership, and those were the days where you
could, man, two strikers up front.
And Robbie, I've said it on your show before. I think to get the best out of Aubameyang and Lacazette, they have to play together as a two.
Yeah, I agree with that. Zesmo says,
the physicality.
You was quicker than Akinfenwa, though.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, God, yeah.
When I see him now, he's going to want to top me up for saying that, right?
No.
Lukaku.
Yeah, right. hunting space and could hold it up. Yeah, okay.
Yeah. It's a good one. Moussa Dembélé.
I could say that. He could do both.
Leon. Yeah, he can do both.
That's a good one. He can do both, yeah.
Yeah. Going back to what you said, this guy says, but we need results. We need results, Kevin. Better.
Yeah. He's right. We do. But you know what? If you're not playing well, you're not going to get the results.
Yeah.
Not with this team anyway.
Ashkay says, Kevin Campbell was a little better version than Emil Heskey. He was a top footballer. Easy Pal says you was a goal langer. You was a goal langer.
I wish I was. I would have got a lot more goals.
N3D says Richarlison. Right?
I suppose Richarlison. Ooh. Richarlison, no. But Richarlison is a good foil for Calvert-Lewin. Because now, have you noticed? Now that
Troy Deeney's
a physical striker. So. Yeah. Maybe I've got a bit of some of these players, I suppose.
If you could get into that change room, what would you be saying to those men? I mean, talk me through Pepe at the weekend. Why does it, you were a professional footballer, your son is a professional footballer, you're around footballers all the time. Talk me through what's going through Pepe's mind when he does what he does.
I think part of that is part of frustration for Pepe, because he's got his chance now, Robbie. He spoke out before he went on international duty and he said he wants a chance. You know, he wasn't disrespectful, but he said he wants a chance. Finally gets his chance and the team ain't playing well. Nothing's really coming off for him as such. And maybe it's a bit of frustration. That's the only thing. I've seen Wrighty frustrated and Wrighty do some stuff. Do you know what I mean? On a pitch. So I can understand if it's frustration, but you are not helping your team if you do petulant stuff like he did. He could have pushed him because he pushed him previously, but he didn't need to do what he done. And I think it's more frustration, Robbie. Why he done it, because that's the only thing I could think of.
Crazy, man. Mallard says, Big Kev loved you as a player. Where do you see us finishing this season? Certainly, we cannot make the top four when you look at our competitors. Well, it's...
Nonsense. Why can't we make the top four? Listen, there's only nine games gone. There's 29 more games.
Mm.
We can, but what we have to do, we have to get grinding. We have to get across that white line, and we've got to start performing, Robbie. Until we start performing, it's gonna be tough for us. We need a win, and we'll take any win. Get to Wolves. Don't want to disrespect the Europa League, but I think we'll win in Mold on Thursday. Get to Wolves. We won there last year. Let's see if we could get a win there. Take us into the North London Derby. And if we could get a win there, Robbie, we're back on track. because there's a back-to-back wins. I know it's going to be hard, Robbie, but the Premier League's hard. The Premier League is hard.
I'm scared of that game, I'll tell you that, right? Jermaine says, Aston Villa lost before and after us, so I don't get the confidence thing. Chances created has been an ongoing problem. Kevin is capping. He's alleged, though, right? Like, he's not having it from you, Kev. He's saying, you know...
Jermaine, this is what I will say. We play Fulham, first game of the season. We create chances. We do, and I know it's Fulham, but you still have to beat them, right? Arsenal's season from that game has gone up and down and up and down. And right now, we are not creating chances. We created chances at Anfield against Liverpool. Did we or did we not? I think Lacazette had a good couple of chances. So we were creating chances. Nobody can't tell me we weren't creating chances, because we were. We had chances virtually against everybody. We created chances at Man United. We created chances against Leicester, but we never took them. Okay? This is what happens. When you're not playing well and you're not taking your chances, everybody starts retracting because people start getting tight. Whether you like it or not, everybody are professionals. Aston Villa, we're talking about Arsenal here. We're not talking about Aston Villa. Aston Villa, yeah, they've just survived relegation. They're playing free right now. They're playing free. They come to the Emirates. What kind of Arsenal is going to turn up? We don't know what type of Arsenal is going to turn up. So, you know, I'm not saying that Arsenal are well-beaters right now. But what I will say is, they are not performing to their ability consistently. And that's why we have this problem with fans questioning Arteta, questioning the players. And it's a mess at the moment. And it needs to change.
Yes, seventh Arisha with a super chat. He says, why isn't anyone questioning Leno's distribution and lack of awareness? There have been instances where players would be open to make a counter, but Leno would kill the vibe by holding onto the ball till the opposing defence regroup. And then I've got this one here from Anand. He says, Kev, awesome player. And Crucial Robbie, you're making any more reggae tracks? No. He says, free Saliba, free Ozil, as we have to pay him at the moment. I mean, talk to me, Kev, man. The Ozil situation.
Listen, Ozil...
We're lacking creativity. We ain't creative.
We're not. Listen, Robbie.
We've got a creative
Listen. We're not lacking creativity.
We are.
We're not.
We're not.
So let me ask you a question then, Robbie. Do we have creative players in the team? Yes or no?
Yes, I believe there are some.
But why aren't we creating? Because they're not playing well enough to create.
No, but so is it the system? It's not the system who plays, Robbie.
It's the players who play. But the system doesn't create the chances. It's the players.
It's too negative. It's too, as I said, it's too regimented. No, Robbie, I'm looking at a team, and to me, it seems like certain players don't have that license. It's too much about...
Which players is that then, Robbie? You tell me. Which players don't have the license?
Well, for starters, right? Pepe, right? That's why he always seems to get dropped to me.
Pepe doesn't have the license.
No, he's that player. He's a free-flowing player. So I just felt up until the other day that he's not trusted by the manager because he's not the type of player.
Yeah, but Robbie, we're not on about trust. Hold on. We're not on about trust. You said we don't create anything. So I asked, do we have creative players? Pepe's one creative player.
We do have creative players, right? But what I'm trying to say is when you play a system, right, for instance, where you're only playing with two midfield players, effectively, two central midfield players, like what we did against Aston Villa, where's the creativity going? Why can't we play with three in midfield against Villa? Why did we just have the two?
Probably because the creativity is on the wings.
I understood it against Manchester United, right? I understood it. Right, because they're a very attacking team. We're away from home. I understood it. Why are we playing at home with two holding midfielders? Why?
Robbie, because the creativity is from the wings.
And if that ain't working, then what?
Robbie, It was never going to work against Aston Villa because the team were atrocious. Listen, Robbie, if you're an attacking player, and you're a creative player, and you say we've got creative players in the team, some, I'm not saying everyone is, you cross that white line and you're picked. You cannot blame the system if the players don't do their job, Robbie. It's your job to create. Pepe, Willian, Saka, Aubameyang, Lacazette. That is their job, is to create. Ceballos in midfield. It's their job.
Okay, I'm gonna bring in James. He's quite new to the team, Kev, right? But he's a very good when it comes to stats. So we got James here.
Oh, we got a stat man. All right.
He's a stat man. Let me bring in James. You, James. How you doing, James?
Yeah, good. How are you guys?
Hi, James.
You're amongst a legend. In Kevin Campbell, you ready here? He's been tearing into me all night, right? So I need a bit of backup here now, James, man. Are we
2v1? 2v1.
Don't let him bully you. Don't let him bully you, James, yeah? Because...
are you asking me to try and disagree with an Arsenal legend? Is that what you're
bringing up for? Come on, give us... We don't... What do we create? You've been doing a lot of shows and you've been talking about creation.
Yeah.
Where do you see the lack of creation?
I know this is so easy to say. I do kind of agree with you both. Like, there are personnel on the pitch who should be doing more from a creative perspective. Your likes of Willian, your Pepe. And in fairness, we do call them out for not doing enough in the game. But then there are certain things like, for example, one of our best chances against Villa came from Tierney putting it in the box to Lacazette. It was a great cross and Lacazette got his head on it. The problem is that the system, as you mentioned, Robbie, it doesn't get Tierney getting up the pitch enough. He's instructed not to do that. So, or at least it looks like he's not. So I do agree there's a bit of both. And I do feel like sometimes I look at the players and they look a little bit restricted, almost like over-instructed. But maybe that's just because, you know, as Kevin pointed out, maybe they're lacking confidence. Maybe it's because they don't feel, just that word, confident. They don't feel confident to express themselves at the moment. So I do think it's a bit of both. I expect more from the players, but I'm not sure if the manager's really taken his hand off the handbrake. So I'm going to agree with you both and just stay on the fence.
Hold on a minute.
Curtis says, mad respect to Kevin, absolute baller in his prime, putting Robbie in his place. Got Robbie stuttering and calling for backup.
Listen, I love coming on, Robbie. You know that. I love speaking to Arsenal people. And the Arsenal fan base. But this is what I would say. People who are questioning Arteta sending the players out negatively, it's just your opinion. But think about it. It doesn't make sense. How can he send them out against Manchester United aggressively and then you get home to Aston Villa and you set them up negatively? It's not the system. The system
didn't,
Robbie. It's the players didn't perform.
Kev, they
didn't
perform.
So how is it negatively? How can he set them up negative if the players don't perform?
Because it was a negative formation. You're at home. All right. Aston Villa, yeah? We all know that Aston Villa, their strength is their midfield. Grealish, John McGinn, Douglas Luiz, that's their strength. Midfield, right? Why are we only playing two players in midfield in that game? Why?
Robbie, because Arteta wants to get around the sides of them because that's where our strength is.
Have you seen that this season?
Robbie, we saw it at Old Trafford the week before.
Different game.
No, yeah, but you're talking about systems and I'm talking about performance. So you can't have it both ways. The system the week before, the players perform and show that they can do it. So when they cross that white line at the Emirates and they don't perform, you can't then turn around and blame the system. The system doesn't make the players. Players make the system.
You, where I do agree with Kevin, sorry to interrupt there, is that whatever system, whatever players go out there from that Arsenal group, they should be beating Villa at home. So actually, kind of regardless of... And Villa are a good side, you know, with all due respect to them. They absolutely have some very good players. And they played really well. But there's definitely a lot of truth in that. Kind of no matter what Arteta really did in that game, we should have been so much better than we were. We were so bad that day.
And it shocked Arteta. I think. Did you see the interview after the game with Arteta, Robbie?
Yeah.
You can't tell me he wasn't a broken man after that game, because I think that performance absolutely shocked him. It shocked him. He, as he said, that is unacceptable. That is not a manager sending him out to be, oh, defensive. No chance. That is not acceptable for an Arsenal team. I agree with you and him on that. But I don't think it's the system. I think it's the players. The players have to take some responsibility, because you know what, Robbie? When you play left back or striker or right back, it's your job to play when you have the ball and when you don't have the ball. And if you only play when the opposition have it, you're not doing your job properly.
I agree with what you say with the players, yeah? But I still think the system, for me, is too negative. We're playing at home against Aston Villa and we're playing two in midfield. I can understand it against United. You know what I mean? They've got Bruno Fernandes. They've got so much attacking. We're away from home. We haven't won there for a very long time. I understood that. That's the right system for that. I get what you're saying about players, but yeah, man, I don't. It's too negative, man. Yeah, I mean, it's too rigid. It's just like, man, you stay there, don't move,
Robbie.
Right? And you can't tell me. I know you're an ex-player, right? And I know, obviously, you're in change rooms, and I hear what you're saying, right? But if you were playing in, but your son who plays for Stoke, yeah, right? You can't tell me that he wouldn't say there's a difference to when he was playing now. And to dare say when Pulis was at the club. I don't know if he was playing.
He weren't there. But one thing I will take. Yeah. Okay, Robbie. All right. So why did Tony Pulis, was it his system or was it the players that got the results?
No.
George Graham, was it the system or was it the players, Robbie?
Simple was he negative? Question. Was George Graham negative, though?
No, Robbie, that's not what I asked you. I asked you, was it the players or was it the system that was successful?
Both.
No, Robbie. It's the players that make the system. It is always the players. Fans can always turn around and say, that's a wrong system, that's a wrong system. If the system, so-called, if the team win in a system, you never question it. It's funny, isn't it? The system never gets questioned if the team win. But when the team lose, the system's wrong.
Okay, let me get a few comments in. Newman says, sorry, Kev. I agree with Robbie. If you set up defensive at home to Villa, you're telling your players they should be scared of the opposition. And they go out and they have a negative mentality. Right?
Newman, Tashi, yeah.
Managers determine the system, he says.
That's right. Managers determine the
system.
No, Robbie. Managers determine the system. Players make the system.
Okay.
If you listen to what I'm saying, because no matter who you play, what system we are playing right now, Arsenal are not playing well enough to win football matches. That is the bottom line. So we could play whatever system you want. We are not good enough.
All right. This guy says, Robbie out there stuttering and nervous, cold sweats and getting bossed by the new Don, Kevin.
Robbie, listen, I know it's this is really a passionate one for a lot of Arsenal fans. And I know, listen, Robbie, I know you've got the eye test because you've been around. You know what it takes. You've seen it over the years.
Yeah.
Can I ask you and all the Arsenal fans this? Do you trust this team when they're not playing well to get results?
No.
so it can't be the system.
What do you mean?
Robbie, if you don't trust the players to get your result when they're not playing well, you can't blame the system.
Now, what I'm saying is this, right? I also can blame the system because I can look on it and say, right, you've got players like, all right, let me explain why. You've got a player like Aubameyang. Man's been killing it for the last two seasons, yeah? Mm-hmm. Now this season, the man's not even getting the ball to, you know, no chances being put out to him. The ball's not getting up to him. Mikel Arteta himself, I think, acknowledged that the system ain't working. That's why he put him through the middle at the weekend, because he's saying to himself, we got our best player and our best player's hardly even seeing the ball. It ain't working. That current system that we're playing is not playing to the strengths, you know? And I know I hear what you're saying, but yeah, if we worked off of your logic, then we could play every, you know, when you were playing then, play you at left back.
Robbie.
Play it right back and then turn around to you and say, oh, it's okay. The player. Kev, Robbie. You should perform.
Robbie,
we want to play to the strengths.
Okay, Robbie.
I want that guy on the ball as much as possible because I know, like you said, right mm-hmm. at the start of the show, that if that chance falls to him mm-hmm. At the weekend instead of Saka, right, we can't guarantee he'll score it, but it's more than likely 70%, 80% that he'll score, right? So I want that to fall to him. But if I'm not getting the ball to him,
so Robbie,
don't blame him.
So, Robbie, you've set me up perfectly. Thank you. Aubameyang starts through the middle at Leeds. Like I know you say, you want him. No, you said no. You want him through the middle.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what happened then?
Now, I'm going to flop your argument because we didn't get to see a full 90 of what could have developed because my man goes like head butts down.
But Robbie,
No,
Robbie, hold on, Robbie.
Kev, you Robbie. Can't just judge it off of what we saw because we didn't Robbie. Get to see the whole thing in 90 minutes.
Robbie, my point is this. You said you want Aubameyang through the centre. Did we play any different to how we were playing before?
I can't judge it because I didn't get to see it for 90 minutes.
Robbie, you're the answer of my question, my brother.
We didn't. No, I will answer your question. We created more chances than we did against Villa.
Did any fall to Aubameyang?
Did we create more chances than we did against Villa?
I'm asking you, did any fall to Aubameyang?
I think two one chances. Did. Was it
one
chance?
What one chance?
At least he was in the box.
So what you're saying is
he was in the box, Kev. You know what I mean? He hit it over the bar, but at least he got the ball. He's in the box. He's hit it over the bar. What
Robbie.
Did he hit? Where was he against Villa? His touch map against Villa weren't even in the box.
Robbie, the touch map against Villa, everybody was all over the place.
No, he's a guy. We want him. He scores the majority of his goals in the box.
Yeah.
His touch map against Villa, he didn't have one touch in the box.
Yeah, Robbie, because we were right? so poor. This is what I'm saying to you.
And then there's acknowledgement by the manager. He's thinking to himself, yeah, it's true. Our best player ain't getting the ball. Next game, he puts him down the middle. And I think it's unfair to judge that because Pepe got sent off after about the 50th minute. That means we had to play literally our whole half where, you know, Aubameyang's having to play virtually as a holding midfielder. So we didn't get to see what could have happened.
Yeah, Robbie.
But I think that was an acknowledgement that the system weren't working.
Robbie.
Yeah, I agree.
Robbie, again, I am going to reiterate what I said at the start. If we don't, we do create, but when we don't take our chances,
yeah,
we
know
come...
That, yeah.
Yeah, but we come unstuck. So it's not the system, Robbie. It's not the system. It's not the system.
All right, let me ask you
players.
All right, if we played, let's say, if you play a Liverpool or a Man City and they create 20 chances and we only create 4, what are our chances of winning the game? They're very low, aren't they?
Robbie, that's what happened in the semi-final against City.
Yeah. True, that came off in that game, but I'm
did
saying...
Did you hear anybody saying the system is wrong?
No, because the system is actually right, because if we try to go toe-to-toe with them, they'll play us off the park.
Robbie.
But the system when we're playing Villa, Villa, not Man City.
So therefore, was it the same system? Do you know what the instruction was to the players against Aston Villa?
Well, I don't know. I don't even know if they knew.
Robbie, so that's why the manager was so shook, because what he was seeing wasn't to his instruction. That's why managers get upset, and that's how managers get pressure, because the players do not perform how the manager wants them to.
Yeah.
But in whatever system it is.
But that might be on the manager as well. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Of course it's on the manager. But the manager can only do so much. He can only prepare you until you cross that white line. Once you cross that white line, I don't want to hear the players have got negative, the handbrake's on. Nonsense. The handbrake isn't on. It's the players that put the handbrake on. Because nobody is stopping the players running. Nobody. Bar themselves.
Come on, Kev. You've had managers, right? I don't know if any, but you know there's certain managers that might say to you, yo, where you go? I don't want you bombing down the wing. I don't want you bombing. You stay there. You're going to tell me. Robbie, come on, Kev. You're going to tell me that.
I've been involved in football for 20-odd years. And you cannot, I've never ever heard a manager say that a left back or a attacking midfielder not to go forward. Never. Never in my whole career. So why should I take it now? Why should I believe what you're saying?
You're saying to me there's no managers out. You may not have heard it. You're going to tell me there's no managers that might say, I don't want you overlapping down. I want you rigid. This is how we're going to play today. You're going to tell me that.
Robbie, what I'm saying to you is I've been at Arsenal and I've been at the West Broms and I've been at Forest and I've been everywhere. There is no manager. It's different where if you've got a lead and you're trying to keep the lead and he said, listen, you sit in there for 5 minutes. But he's not saying do not go forward. No manager has ever done sitting there for five, sitting there for 10. Tony Adams said to Lee Dixon, Lee, you tucking round there. Nigel, you tucking round there. But they were our strength as well. They used to bomb on. Nobody stopped them, Robbie.
But okay. Where I do agree with Robbie is I think managers can put restrictions on players, because if you look at our fullbacks, for example, Kieran Tierney and Bellerin, Bellerin's got a lot of pace and Tierney's probably the best crosser of the ball in the squad. And Tierney's being played predominantly as a left centre-back, or at least before the Leeds game he was. And Bellerin was being told to play as like an inverted wing-back. Basically, he was coming inside in midfield all the time. And those natural positions that they were clearly being instructed to play against, they don't get the best out of their qualities. So isn't that... Because I agree with you. When it gets to the last 20 minutes and you're 1-0 down to Villa, you've got to go for it. Forget instruction. You've got to go and you've got to attack and you've got to show instinct and you've got to show drive and you've got to show like the nature of being a footballer. But for that first bit, that first half hour or whatever, when you're carrying out the manager's instructions, is that not on Arteta if we're not seeing the best out of Tierney or we're not seeing the best out of Bellerin? Isn't that on Arteta more and his system? By the way, I love Arteta. I back him. I'm so Arteta in. I know he's going to get it right. But I do question those
I back
things.
Him as well.
Well, listen, guys. I don't think, and I know it feels like it's heated, but it's just a difference of opinion. Do you know what I mean? That's all it is. It's a difference of opinion. One thing I will say to you is this. Sometimes the space isn't wide. Sometimes the space is inside. So, if you're a fullback and there's no space on the outside, why would you go on the outside? You've got to, as a footballer, you have to think smart and say, right, I know the space is on the inside, so I've got to utilise the inside. And as Robbie quite rightly said, one run at Leeds where Bellerin picked it up, he went inside, and that's how we created the opportunity for Saka. That is a thinking footballer. Wouldn't you think it would have been easier for Mikel Arteta if you think that he restricts them, for him to say to Bellerin, no, don't go forward. Just sit there because we're only down to 10 men. But Bellerin went for it. It's up to the player to do. The manager can only do so much from the sideline. Once you make your decisions when you're on the pitch.
Okay. It's loads of comments, man. Guna1990 says, do we have a bottom five team in the Premier League in terms of attacking talent? No. Do we have a bottom five team in the Premier League in terms of chances, goals, possession in the final third, etc.? Yes, he says. It's the system.
But again, Robbie, you could always fall back on the system and blame the system.
Mm.
How many systems have Arsenal used this season?
That's the question. Too many. That's okay. Another thing. That's thing. You make another good point there. Every minute we're changing.
Yeah, but Robbie, why do we change? Because we're not good enough. We are not good enough as a team to say we're going to play 4-3-3 and we can take on anybody. We are not good enough. So yeah, until we get there, he has to get the players to try to put the players in a position to win. That's what he has to do, I'm afraid. Until he gets his players, that's what we have to do.
I agree with you. So do you think he's finding short-term solutions just to get instant results?
Well, he has to try. 100% he has to try.
Oh, I agree.
And he's not doing very well at the moment, but there's too much quality for it to keep this way all the way through. We will improve, but I could tell you this much. I think Mikel Arteta can't wait to get to the January window.
he definitely wants to get his own team. I mean, we got James on because James has been analysing what Mikel Arteta has been saying at his press conference today. Obviously, we got the game against Mulder on Thursday, and I wanted to find out what Mikel Arteta has been saying ahead of that game, James. What's he been talking about in his press conference?
Yeah, well, obviously, the main talking point was, of course, Pepe. And, you know, there was a lot of reaction to the incident. I mean, it got a little over the top. People saying, is this the end of Pepe? Was it? But I guess that was born out of the fact that Arteta, in terms of the amount he played him, suggested that maybe didn't rate him too much. But he really defended Pepe today, which I was really glad to see. He said that he's basically going to play tomorrow, which is great. It was an opportunity against Mulder for him to show what he's capable of. I'll just pick out some of the good quotes from it. He said that Pepe had a really good reaction, the way he apologised, the way he understood his responsibility. Hopefully tomorrow we can see the player that we want to see and have a good reaction to help this team. And when he was asked whether this was sort of the start of the end of his Arsenal career, he said, absolutely not. It's not about that. And I don't like that type of statement. I will give Nico my full support all the time. So that was really encouraging, I thought. I was glad to hear that.
Yeah, all right, brilliant. But let me ask I'm going to ask this to Kev. And somebody asking the question. He said, Arteta, and my brother was backing this one as well. I don't necessarily, but I'd like to get Kev's view on it as an ex-footballer. He says, Arteta threw Pepe to the Lions in his post-match interview. Now, after the match, when asked, I don't know if you saw the commentary over here, Kev, because I know you do, you'll be over sunning yourself.
No, I was back. Yeah, I was back.
I know because a lot of people don't realise that Kev's always over in Spain at the weekends commenting on the Premier League over there. You're the English.
We're La Liga. We do La Liga. No, we do La Liga.
You don't even do Premier League. It's La Liga.
No, Premier League. It's La Liga.
Okay, La Liga X. We can ask Kev about transfers as well, then, right? But anyway, right? After the game, you saw Arteta pretty public dressing down. You know, when asked about, you know, Pepe, he just said unacceptable. He was really angry. If you was in Pepe's place, would you have thought, no, why did you sort of say that in public? Or do you think what the manager said was right? Do you think he's right?
100% is right. I mean, come on. How can anybody defend what Pepe done?
Now, I agree with you, but I was having this argument with my brother because my brother was saying that my brother was saying what that guy said, that he thought that he threw him to the wolves.
Yeah, but again, that's another comment that fans make, that he threw him to the wolves. No, he told the truth. Why can't people hear the truth and accept the truth? Nicola Pepe probably could have cost Arsenal a win in that game.
Certainly cost us all 3 points.
Right. As you said, Robbie, you wanted Aubameyang through the middle, but we need him through the middle with 11 players on the pitch. And as the game gets stretched later on, he might have had a good opportunity. But that cost us because all of a sudden we have to get defensive.
Mm.
So why is it, again, Robbie, these players and people now, they're so soft. Stop being soft. Arsenal is not a club that is built on soft. Arsenal are built on tough-minded, proper football people. And the fans know it. And I've got to say, you got to have words with Laurie, man. You got to have words with your bro. Because let me tell you, do you reckon George, if somebody done something stupid, do you reckon George Graham would say, hold on a minute. That's unacceptable, because it is unacceptable. It cost Arsenal a potential 3 points, Robbie.
Yeah, definitely. What else was he saying there, James, at the press conference? Give some other things.
Yeah, lots to talk about fans returning next week. He said the club's worked really hard, obviously, to, potentially from the 2nd of December, once lockdown ends, obviously, depending what tier everyone's in, potential for up to 2,000 to 4,000 fans. I mean, that's going to be great. I know it might not be the same, but it's going to be... I know you're not as keen on the idea, Robbie, but it's a step in the right direction, isn't it?
Do you know, Robbie, as a player, getting some fans in the stadium, I mean, is unbelievable. It's brilliant. Because you've been starved of that. You know, listen, and people complain about the Emirates, the fan base, but do you know what? Having the fans there makes a difference.
You think even like, say, 2,000 to 4,000 would make a difference to the players?
Yeah, big time. Especially at home, because it's your home fans. It's all going to be all Arsenal, you know, against the opposition. Because when the opposition come, they feel all right. Villa felt all right coming to the Emirates. No fans. Arsenal, you know, we could go and do our game plan. But let's get some fans. Let's put some heat under some of these teams. Definitely.
He says better to have 4,000 fans booing than 60,000.
That humor's funny, you know. He's funny. But hey, listen, whatever it is, it's better to even have the fans in. So whether they're booing or cheering, it's just be great to have the fans there. Because when they played in Vienna, there was a crowd there, wasn't there?
Yeah, yeah.
There was a crowd in Vienna. So, you know, they come back to win it in Vienna. So it'd be great to have it at the Emirates.
Okay. Anything else he said there of any significance?
Yeah, I thought this was an interesting one. He was asked about whether a potential return for Jack Wilshere was on the cards. He said that it's not. He said, we haven't analysed the situation. He always speaks in such a like particular way, doesn't he? We haven't analysed that situation. What I can tell you about Jack is what I've said in the past. As a player, as a teammate, and as a person, I rate him really highly. But yeah, they've not looked at that. Would you take him back, Robbie? As like on a pay as you play? What about you, Kevin? Would you have him back? He's an Arsenal man.
Yeah, he is an Arsenal man. And I rated Jack Wilshere, but he's been injured too many times. I don't think he could really... If he couldn't keep himself right at West Ham, no, not at Arsenal, unfortunately.
That if we took him back, we got a guy that we could bring back that's already there, innit? In Ozil. Because I know we're running out of time and I've kind of really stretched out the time on Kev. And I'm really grateful, Kev, man, for you coming on.
Listen, I've got a bit of time, so don't worry.
You've got a bit of time,
made the time
right.
for you, Robbie, yeah.
All right, good. Well, I've got to ask you this now because I ain't been able to ask you this.
Ozil,
the O word, right? Now, if you was in his shoes, man, and you want to play, innit? And you... This don't make no sense. What's going on, does it? No. Ozil just. I mean, how do you feel? And the other thing I'd like to ask you, Kev, as a player that was obviously you played for Arsenal, you're in the dressing room. Could it be having the effect on other players? Because there's going to be some players in that dressing room that are good friends at Ozil, and they're going to be looking at it and they're going to be thinking, "Yeah, man, they're treating this guy like this is not right, man." This. Do you think that there could be an element of that happening as well?
Well, one thing I will say is no. And I'll tell you the reason why. Because it seems to me, Mikel Arteta, when you look at when he took over, Robbie, Ozil played. Then we shut down for COVID. And then it was a matter of like a mini pre-season, everybody coming back. And from that moment forward, Ozil never featured.
Right? That coincided with a pay cut thing, didn't it?
Well, I don't think it's anything to do with the pay cut.
So what is
and it? Here's the reason why. Because Mikel Arteta said in pre-season, and I'm sure I heard you say it in your transfer thing, that everybody, Ozil, Guendouzi, everybody's got a clean slate.
Yeah.
Everybody starts again in pre-season. But yet, Guendouzi didn't want to know. That's why he went off to wherever he went off to. Mesut Ozil, as the star man, the biggest earner, if he buckled down and knuckled down to do what he's supposed to do, I don't think there would be any problem. I think he would be involved. But I think the problem is Mesut Ozil didn't do that. And remember, it's the third manager now. Little, obviously, Freddie was just a touch. It's the third manager who has dropped him. Can all three managers be wrong? And just Ozil be right? I beg to differ on that. And I'm not anti-Ozil. I am Ozil. If Ozil wanted to play, Robbie, he would be playing. But I don't think he's as committed as he makes out.
Serious?
Yeah, truthfully.
Okay, strong opinions there. Mad Nacho Man says, Kevin Campbell as a striker, who do you rate more out of Kane and Aubameyang? Oh, okay.
Well, I rate them both, but Aubameyang has been more consistent, although Harry Kane has scored a lot of goals. Mm. What Harry Kane's doing this season is adding assists because Son's on fire.
Mm.
You know, so listen, at the moment, Kane's up there, but I'd like to see what happens at the end of the season because I think Aubameyang will still be there or thereabouts, Robbie. I think once this team finds its mojo, somebody's going to get a hiding.
You think?
Yeah, someone's going to get a hiding because there's a lot of frustration in these guys, man.
I hope he's got them. That's what, you know what? That's where they could turn it right around. Go into that game and really put in a top performance against
your nearest rivals.
But then they did that against Man United. I thought they put in a brilliant performance. I was so happy with what I saw that day. And then I think that's what's really upped the frustration levels, right? Because we saw that. And then they come back the next week against Villa. And you're like, yo, what's that? And that's why I had to start to wonder to myself, were these men complacent? Were they just riding off of that Man United win? And just saying to themselves, yeah, it's Villa, man. Yo. Even the manager. Because even I'm looking at, I'm like, same formation. Is that just a thing like, well, it worked against United. Villa, idiot team, it worked against them. It's, I don't know. I just got that impression.
Well, Robbie, again, when you play against Villa, it's all up here. So you're saying, you know, we should have changed the system because Villa's midfield strong and we should change. No, hold on, we're Arsenal. We should be able to keep the same system and the players perform out of that system. But when the players don't perform, Robbie, we come unstuck, unfortunately. We come unstuck against Leicester when we should have beat Leicester. And then we come unstuck. Remember, before the Leicester game, Leicester had lost a couple of games.
Mm.
Got battered. Aston, I think Villa were one of them who battered them at their place. Before Aston Villa got slapped up by other teams, who were lesser teams, come to us and battered us, and we don't perform against either. So again, this season so far has been such a yo-yo. What we want, we crave, is consistency. But the players have been consistently inconsistent.
Yeah. By the way, Joe, he's been spamming this, right? Saying, Robbie, pay your respects. I did that at the start of the show. About Heavy D. So obviously you're just joining it now, maybe. But of course, rest in peace to Heavy D. And, you know, I still can't believe that news. Yeah. I still can't believe it. So
Shocking.
To Heavy D. And also, as we spoke at the start of the show as well, about Maradona as well, which again, unbelievable news. So, you know, we did do that. We have paid respects to Heavy D. Come on, what do you think this is? James, just before you go there, we're coming towards the end of the show. Did he say anything about the young players that have gone, that have travelled? Because I know that Balogun's travelled, hasn't he?
Yeah.
Miguel Aziz, a lot of people are getting really excited about this kid.
Yeah, three sort of quite technical midfielders, and Aziz, Smith Rowe and Cottrell have all gone, which is great because it's kind of what we feel we're lacking in midfield. So hopefully one of them, if not most of them, can make the step up. In terms of the press conference, the sort of the good news was around Follerin Balogun, young striker who's been absolutely tearing it up with the under-23s and in the academy.
Remember, Kev, last time we had Kev on, right? I think that would have been earlier on in when it was a lockdown.
Yeah.
You were talking about Balogun, didn't you? You were bigging him up then, weren't you? Yeah.
Yeah, somebody who knows how to score like that, and he scores a load of different goals. He hunts space. He's hungry. And look, the Europa League, you can give him a chance now. You can give him a run out. So I want to see him.
Hmm.
Yeah, I agree. Especially because Nketiah and Lacazette aren't really at it either. So there's definitely a door there that's open for Balogun. But he said that things are going really well with the contract and that he wants to keep him. So it looks like he's going to be staying at the Arsenal, which I think is really good news.
Yeah, yeah. Sign him up, man. Don't let him go. Don't let him go nowhere else.
So is that good, Kev?
Robbie, I just think when you got a player who can score goals like that, you want to nurture him. You want to develop him. Because what we've seen so many players leave Arsenal and then go on and do the business elsewhere. The prime example is Serge Gnabry. You know, we knew that he had talent, but at Arsenal, he never really fulfilled it. Goes somewhere else and develops, and then all of a sudden, he's a world-class talent. No, let's get him in the building. If he has to go out on loan, you loan him out, and let him get some minutes, and then you get him back in the building, and you unleash him.
Saliba, is that what we... I mean, again, as I don't know. I'm asking all these questions because as a football fan, I find it hard to understand what's going on in that situation. And obviously, you're a player, you were a player, and you understand you've still got a son who plays, so you understand what goes on, the ins and outs and that. Why Saliba? What's this? I don't understand this, man.
Robbie, this is... I agree with you. Can you believe it? I agree with you, Robbie. Right? I don't know what Saliba needs to do, because you know what, Robbie. Mustafi's injured and comes from the treatment table past Saliba and onto the subs bench. I would much rather Saliba go in there, make mistakes, because he's got to learn somehow. He's got to be a part of it. He's got to be a part of it. Get him in there, incorporate him, because you know what? Rob Holding, he struggles with injuries at times. He struggles with quick players at times. Get Saliba in. Let's see him. He's been at the club a year and a bit. We've not even seen him yet. Let's see him.
It's crazy. Kev, you're obviously, as I said, you're on the weekends. You're over in Spain, commenting on Spanish football, English La Liga expert. Talk to us about Emery, man. Oh, it's just going right.
Well, it's funny.
The man's kicking it up in the in La Liga at the moment.
Is he kicking it up? Well, listen, let me just tell you this. I could only tell you what I saw.
Okay.
And I covered the game between Real Madrid and Villarreal at Villarreal. Real Madrid had 7 top players missing. No Sergio Ramos, no Casemiro, no Benzema. You know, there was a lot of the top boys out. No Valverde. And they had Mariano in there. You know, players that hardly make the squad, to be honest. And it was a good game of football, Robbie. It actually, Villarreal reminded me of watching Arsenal, where you play, we play.
Not
negative, but you play, we play. So the opposition can play, but when we have it, we play, if that makes sense. There wasn't, we'll stop you and then we'll, you know, put it on you and dominate the game. They didn't dominate the game. And first half was all virtually all Real Madrid. Real Madrid should have been out of sight. Second half, Villarreal came back into it. They made some changes, brought on Chukwueze and another couple. And they ended up equalizing and from the penalty spot, and probably could have taken it if they took, could have won the game if they took their chances. But isn't that how it was again for Arsenal? One half would be good and one half would be bad. So, you know,
I'm just bringing him into the conversation because there's been, obviously, there's been a lot of comparisons made because he's doing well in La Liga with Villarreal. And people are like, look, we got rid of Emery, and we were right to get rid of Emery, by the way. But we got rid of Emery, and look what he's doing at Villarreal. And now look what Arteta's doing. I mean, one thing I do agree with you on, definitely, is that we got to have patience with this guy. I do think he's a good manager. I do think, like, he's still finding his feet. But I do
learning on the job. Yeah.
He's learning on the job. And I do think he don't have his team yet either. So I definitely agree with you on that. But I'm still going to stick with, I say, system.
We're not going to agree on that one, Robbie, are we?
We ain't going to agree. We ain't going to agree on that one. Right? But Kev, you know what? It's been absolutely brilliant having you on tonight, man. You know what I mean? I love your passion. Always passionate about Arsenal, and you've been fantastic tonight. You know what I mean? A lot of people say that you've come on the show and put me in my place.
Robbie, look, me and you always have a little battle, don't we? We always have a little battle. Listen, but it's lovely to come on. It's nice to meet you, James. I've seen some of your videos, etc. I do watch you. Just let me tell you, I do keep an eye on you, and everything. But listen, it's always great. It's the Arsenal family. So whether people agree, everybody's opinion is valid. I can only tell you my opinion, Robbie, and I don't agree with you. That's all.
Kev, thank you very much, man. Kevin Campbell, Arsenal legend. Thank you very much as well, James.
Thanks,
and thank
James.
You, everybody, thanks, to watch tonight. And once again, you know, our condolences go out to the family of Heavy D. It's a really sad news today that he passed away. On behalf of everybody at AFTV, I mean, we're still in shock. And then, like, the other shocking news today about Maradona as well, an absolute legend of the game. Yes, we all hated him for the hand of God, but what a player, what a brilliant player. I mean, you know, I'd love to see that sort of player Arsenal right now, right? But then he'd probably be playing rigid and wouldn't be able to get forward and make...
No, you'd be saying it's the system, Robbie.
The system wouldn't suit him. Thanks, everybody, and have a good evening.